Thank you. 2012, it seems to me, is a very interesting year to be British, a British person living in Britain, because by dint of the Olympics and the Jubilee and the Paralympics, we're kind of doing quite a lot of national navel-gazing. Now, it seems to me that as a musician, one very interesting way of exploring or understanding a people, a culture, is, of course, through its music. And I think it would be fair to say that we British are a nation of quiet melancholics. You know, the rain, it does rain every day. There is a kind of grinding reality about our culinary traditions. And indeed, if you talk to a cabbie in London about the upcoming games, you're expecting, certainly I'm expecting, as a creature of the countryside, I come to London, I go, oh, isn't it exciting? The game's coming here. And all he or she will ever say to me, well, the traffic's going to be shit. Which seems kind of sad. Now, if we look at our national sort of melodic DNA, for want of a better phrase, a tune like Greensteve's, for instance, probably our most celebrated folk tune, if you think about it, it's absolutely shot through with what Shakespeare rather poetically called the dying fool. You remember Orsino, who is kind of drunk with a kind of love misery in the opening scene of Twelfth Night, and he says he likes nothing better than a tune which has a dying fool, something so kind of beautifully, elegantly, tragic and wondrous about that. So Greensleeves, think about it. Brief burst of sunshine in the chorus, ladies and gentlemen. Okay, that's all we have really. That is our culture enshrined in song. It's a sad but very true fact. Think of our national anthem. What on earth does that say about us as a nation? Vitality and optimism and sunshine even, and all we've got is that dirge-like tune. Do you know, I often find, if I've got a melody stuck in my head, do you know how we all have this from time to time? One melody that will not go away, goes round and round in a kind of endless circling pattern. I find my only fail-safe option is to sing just literally a couple of bars of the national anthem to myself. It acts like Domestos, kills any known tune dead. But here's the funny thing about the National Anthem, you may not know this, the National Anthem was actually born as a piece of subversive singing, a kind of polemic. You remember that Bonnie Prince Charlie was set on trying to gain the English throne. So this tune started to emerge out of the theatres of London as a kind of, as an act of solidarity, an anthem of solidarity to prop up good old King George. So, you know, it had a good start, but sadly a tune that none of us would really wish to take much joy in. Anyhow, it's an interesting thing, this idea of the dying fall perpetuates. It's still alive and well in our culture today. Never mind, I'll find someone like you. You see, it's full of the dying fall, the Druid, there's Adele. She's conquered America with tunes like this. It's amazing that they are also in thrall to our dying fall. But here's another thing, the dying fall doesn't just exist in melodies, it also exists, crucially, in good British bass lines. There's a particular type of bass, or bass kind of device, a compositional device, that was beloved particularly of the great Henry Purcell, arguably the greatest composer that we've ever spawned. And these basses, these bass melodies, were called ground basses, and basically they would go round and round and round on a cyclical basis, with the idea being that the melody could then shift, this sort of shifting landscape of melody above these tunes. And they're wonderful. I mean, they can be really pithy, like this. That one simple bass line going round and round and round, and of course that feels very kind of obvious to us. I mean, dance music of today is based on a very similar principle. The most famous grand bass of all is that from Dido's Lament in the opera Dido and Aeneas. Reinvents itself constantly over the fixed certainty of this bass line. I think there's something in that, in the British character. We are kind of glumly accepting of our lives the way they are. And in fact, there's a track by Plan B which is attempting to chronicle what happened last year, 2011, a year of riots in the UK, of course, and famously in other parts of the world. And what the song does so brilliantly is it sort of accepts that this is how things are. The very fact, I suppose, that we as a culture have never really had a revolution. A sense of glum, quiet acceptance. The kind of almost numb inevitability of this rolling bass line that goes round and round and round. As Feste says at the end of Twelfth Night, the rain, it raineth every day. We can't really change anything terribly much. So this quality of ground bass, of this kind of, you know, ongoing sameness is something which persists. I mentioned electronic dance music just now, but there's a great track by Portishead I just want to play you a little bit of now, all based around one four-note bass riff. Round and round and round. Something wonderful about being caught up in the momentum of that, that unstinting, unchanging thing. Now, here's the thing. It seems to me that music becomes most exciting when the culture it represents has something to kick against. There are many pundits who say that the last time British pop music, if I can use that term very broadly, was genuinely febrile and exciting was during the Thatcher government. Well, interestingly, where I live in Somerset, I am a fully paid up and proud member of the West Country community. My county council led the country, probably for the first time in its entire existence, with this astonishing decision it made about a year ago. It decided to cut its arts funding by 100%, which is a fairly eye-watering reality. Where does that leave us? With even less culture in Somerset than we had before, apart from the legendary Glastonbury Festival, we live in a kind of cultural desert, certainly musically speaking. I mean, there are no orchestras playing anything. There's no opera, there's no dance. There's very little by way of smaller level gigs. So I decided to do what I could to change that trend. So I've started this festival, which Rosie mentioned just now, called Orchestra in a Field. As you can probably tell, even though I'm a conductor and I spend most of the time conducting symphonic literature, my appetites as a musician are incredibly wide. So I'm as happy listening to or exploring a track by Portishead as I am conducting a symphony by Mozart. And this festival is a reflection of that. It seems to me there's this kind of bizarre idea that we've grown very used to, which is that all the different categories within music are mutually exclusive. That if you like R&B, of course you won't like Wagner. If you like Wagner, of course you won't like hip-hop. If you like hip-hop, of course you won't like Mozart. So it goes on and on and on. I beg to differ. I don't believe that's true at all, and I'm willing to bet that most of you in this room have an active daily engagement with music, and you've probably got an iPod rammed full of all sorts of music. So I decided I wanted to create a festival in Somerset, principally for the people of Somerset, but also for all of you good Londoners, which is based on a kind of A to Z of music. It's a festival, uniquely I think, where you can hear a world-class performance of Carmen, but you can also see Professor Green do his first ever gig with a symphony orchestra. You can see Mussorgsky pictures and exhibition, but in between those wonderful fiery movements that Mussorgsky wrote for full orchestra, you get kind of kick-ass improvisations, responses to that music, using only Mussorgsky's materials, but filtered through electro-disco, trip-hop, any number of other musical styles or worlds. So you have the chance to re-engage with Mussorgsky's materials, but through a variety of different lenses. That, to me, is valuable. Then we've also got a project, you might have seen, I did a film last year called Scrap Heap Orchestra, which is a somewhat churlish attempt to make an entire symphony orchestra out of rubbish, which didn't sound like rubbish. We played it at the Proms last year, it was great, and that's being reconstituted. But the main reason for telling you about this festival is because it's the launching of a project which is of intense importance to me. I've got four children. My youngest child, she's five now, she was born with cerebral palsy. So this has been an astonishing eye-opener for me in all sorts of ways. And aside from her wonderful, splendid existence, she has introduced me to a whole community of people that were invisible to me before. In other words, the disabled community. And I found myself looking at the Paralympics and thinking what an extraordinary model that was. How it has taken 50 years, but in the course of 50 years, we've arrived at this point now. I think it's going to be very historic, the Paralympics coming to London this year, because it was a British initiative originally. But there cannot be any longer an intelligent person on the planet who doesn't absolutely believe in the validity of Paralympian sport. So as a musician, I'm thinking, okay, sport, yeah, it's pretty universal. Music, much more so. Everyone on the planet engages with music pretty much every day. So where are the platforms for gifted, disabled musicians? You know, all the orchestras I conduct around the world, I can think of, I think, three players I've met in 20 years who are disabled in any of those groups. Now that has to change. So I'm forming this thing called the British Paraorchestra, and it's playing its debut performance at the festival. I just want to show you the briefest of films to introduce three of the amazing musicians I've so far encountered in this.
I'm 22 and I'm a left-handed pianist, and I was born without my left hand. Right hand. Can I do that one again?
You do.
When I'm making music, I feel like a pilot in the cockpit flying an aeroplane. I become alive.
An instrument again than walk. There's so much joy and things I could get from playing an instrument and performing. It's removed some of the paralysis.
So that's the British Paraorchestra, ladies and gentlemen. We're making its first ever performance at Orchestra Field. Thank you very much. Now, this is my parting shot. I just want to quickly come back to this idea of the dying fall. I've got about a minute in order to see if I can get you singing in four-part harmony to reacquaint yourselves with the dying fall. What do you think? You up for it?
Yeah.
British people love singing. We know this. Look at our football. We sing like anything at the football, okay? So any of you that might think you'd rather eat cold soup than sing, you know it's not true. You love to sing. But this great little song for you, it goes like this. Rose, 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 when shall I see thee wed? I marry that thou wilt when I am dead. Typically optimistic, ladies and gentlemen, lovely old Tudor folk song. So I'm going to sing a phrase, I want you to sing it back. Rose, 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 rose.
Rose, 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 rose.
When shall I see thee wed? That thou wilt,
I marry that thou wilt,
when I am dead.
When I am dead.
Beautiful tune, isn't it? Do you see how it builds that third phrase? I marry that thou wilt. That's the X Factor scoop there, ladies and gentlemen. Guaranteed to win you friends. Okay, let's try it all together from the start. Go! Rose, 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 rose. When shall I see thee wed? I marry that thou wilt when I am dead. Very nice, but you sound a little prim, dare I say. It's a little prim. We need a little bit more protein in what you're doing, ladies and gentlemen. A little bit more protein. Perhaps you'd like to stand up, that always helps. Come on, on your feet. Come on, come on, come on. Here we go. Ready? From the top. Go!
Rose, 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 rose. When shall I see thee wed? I marry that thou wilt when I am.
Once more, go!
Rose, rose, rose.
Come on!
When shall I see thee?
Hot climax! I marry that thou wilt when I am dead. That's a little bit more like it. Now let's make some four-part harmony. You're group one, you guys out there on the balcony. About half this section is group two, this is group three, and this will be group four. So you better be good, because you're finishing it off. Okay, are you ready, group one? Three, four! Group two!
Rose!
Fantastic, ladies and gentlemen. So I suggest to you tomorrow, when you're going about your daily business, just do a little bit of dying fall spotting. You know, it's a bit like arse watching, really. Just checking out the dying fall, and you'll hear it all around you all day long. Ladies and gentlemen, thank you very much.